Hi, I'm Fred Coury, and welcome to my Power Rock drum system video. Today we're going to be learning a lot of things, from borrowing with taste to twirling and stick tricks. And we're also going to hear some things that I played with Cinderella, as well as my new band Arcade. And sit back and relax. I'm going to play everything that I do in 8-bar sequences, so you can play along and or study them and just go with it. I'd like to begin right now by going into borrowing with taste, which is really what I call stealing, but you do it your own way and it comes out your own style. And the first example I'd like to give is from a band called The Producers way back when. The drummer did a really interesting fill in the middle of a song, and I changed it into one of the Cinderella songs called Sick for the Cure. I'll play The Producers version first and then do mine. 1, 2, 3, 4. That was the producer's version. Now what I did was just took the thing and turned it around at the end and turned it into Sick for the Cure on Cinderella's Heartbreak Station record. I also played it on a cowbell, but as you can see, I don't have it right here. So I'm going to use the bell of the cymbal, and this is what I did. That was my version of the producer's song. So as you can see, you can take anything that you have and just play it your own way, do a little turn on it, and it becomes your own. I'd also like to demonstrate right now something that I learned from Mickey Coury, who is probably my favorite drummer. He's a drummer for Bryan Adams and Hall & Oates and everybody. He does a certain thing off the toms, whereas when he's playing, he does a tom fill but keeps the snare beat on the 2 and 4. At all times. So I took one of his ballads and used it in my own. So what I'd like to play for you now is off of the record from Bryan Adams, and this is the fill from Victim of Love. Okay, that was the Bryan Adams version and the Mickey Coury version. What I'd like to play now is something that I did on the song Heartbreak Station off the album, the same title. And that is pretty much the same thing, just keeping the snare on the 2 and 4 and playing the fill around it. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, that was my version of the Mickey Coury fills. Another thing I like to do is if I hear a song and it sounds like a certain drummer that I like or a certain band that I like, I really like to try to become that person when I'm playing, such as Liberty DeVito. Something he always does is 32nd notes on his kick drum with the cymbals for 16th notes and then a fill afterwards. Or Mickey Coury, again, with the 2 and 4 snare beats going around the toms so that the snare never stops, and it's really fun to do number one, and number two, it kind of gets the point across a little more of what you're trying to do. If there's a favorite drummer you like, try to become that person while you're playing it. It's really fun, but it works. I've been on the road for about 6 years now, and I keep getting the same question over and over and over again. What happened with Cinderella and the Long Cold Winter record, and Andy Johns, and Cozy Powell, and Denny Carmassi, and all these people, the Brady Bunch, whatever it was. I'd like to straighten that out right now. What happened was, Cinderella was in the studio with Andy Johns, who's worked with some of the greatest drummers in the world, John Bonham and Charlie Watts, and he didn't think it was quite cutting it. So I said, all right, well, that's the way it is. It must not be cutting it. We brought in Cozy Powell to do the drum tracks. He didn't think anything was wrong with them, but he ended up cutting the tracks anyway, exactly to what I had played initially. Andy also said Cozy wasn't cutting it and got Denny Carmassi in. So once that happened, I felt pretty good about the whole thing. I said, well, it's not just me. You know, if Cozy isn't getting it, then, you know, whatever is wrong is wrong. But there are no hard feelings between Andy and I. In fact, I tried to get Andy to get to do this new record, but because of prior obligations, he couldn't do it. But Andy and I are great friends, and we will work again at one time, so there's no bad blood there. There was two things that came out of it that I'd like to tell everybody. Number one, never give up, because I was at the point of giving up. I thought that was it. This guy is saying I'm terrible. I must be terrible. I went into the studio. I practiced and practiced and practiced as much as I could, and I came back for the tour rehearsals, and the band was freaking. They thought it was the greatest thing in the world. So something really good did come out of that, and that's it made my eyes open to playing with a click and really getting tight with myself as a drummer, so it helped me out a lot. So the point I'm trying to make is don't quit and don't give up. If somebody tells you you're the worst drummer in the world, you can overcome that. Don't ever lose your confidence, because I lost it once, and it's the worst thing possibly. That will ruin you if you lose your confidence. So keep your confidence up and just know you're a great drummer and keep going and practice and practice and practice, and anything can happen. You know, all your dreams can come true. I mean, look at me. What am I doing here, right? Okay, great. All right, we're back with rock groupings. What I like to do is put together a few little things, which I'm going to show you in a couple minutes. And I like to play them before a show. It just, you know, loosens you up a little bit. What I call them is chops in a bind. You can come up with them in about 15 seconds, and they turn out to be really, really cool fills. They're all linear, which means nothing hits at the same time. And you have that little pamphlet there. I'd like you to read along right now. I'd like to do number one for you and show you how it's done out really quickly, and then you can work it up to speed, and it turns into a really cool groove. I've got a sheet right here that I just did myself just a little while ago, and I'd like to play number one for you right now. So follow along at home. Okay. One, two, three, four. Now, up to speed, it sounds like this. One, two. I'd like to show you a few more of these. You can practice them on your own. But I'm going to show them to you really slow, and you can follow along and work them up to whatever speed you want. They'll turn into really, really cool grooves. I'm going to start with number two now. One, two, three, four. Okay, I'm going to number three now. Follow along. The beauty of these things are that you don't have to read music for them. You just go ahead and write whatever you want, which I'll demonstrate in a few minutes. You don't have to read, and you can just follow along right here. I just learned these things, so I'm going to do them slow. That's the only excuse I can come up with. Can't play them fast because I can't, because I just wrote them, okay? Here we go. Number three. Thank you. Okay, this is number four. One, two, three, four. This is number five. Follow along in your little pamphlets. You can do these at any speed, remember. Alright, what I'd like to do right now is show you exactly how to write these things out. They're very easy and they just take a few seconds. I'm going to write two of them out. The first one, I'm going to write one of the patterns that I'm just making up. And another one, I'm just going to have some people out here in our vast audience of people calling them out. Okay? First thing you do, let's just write three lines. Line one is the hat. Line two, snare. Line three is the kick. Now, what you do is just put hi-hat, kick, snare, anywhere. 16 beats. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. I'll play that for you right now. I don't know what it is or what I just wrote, but I'll play it. You're gonna have to turn around and look at this one, okay? Look at that, because I just wrote it. Don't know what the heck I just did, but it just shows you the ease of the whole thing. Now I'm going to have our studio audience participate and just call out certain lines, and we'll see what we come up with. Our studio audience consists of Carmine and Saul. Okay, let's call out some lines, guys. Let's make up some
snare cool
snare line.
Hi-hat.
Hi-hat.
Try the kicker.
Kick.
Snare.
Kick.
Snare.
Hi-hat.
Hi-hat.
Snare.
Kick.
Hi-hat.
Kick.
How many is that?
14.
Okay. Hi-hat, hi-hat.
15. 16.
And good luck.
Thank you. Thanks very much for making this so easy. Okay. Let's try this one, everybody, and you at home in this wonderful audience of ours. Okay, ready? Here we go. Yeah. Okay, ready? One, two, three, four. Pretty close. I think it's there. Anyway, that's the simplicity in these things. If you can work them up and just take an hour to practice them all, you'll get them really, really fast, and they'll turn into amazing grooves and amazing fills. And you know what? I'm sick of teaching this stuff. I don't even know it. As you just saw, I can't figure any of this stuff out. What am I doing teaching you? Why am I here? I have no clue. Okay? What I'm trying to do is just have a bunch of fun. I'm here to rock and roll and to do tricks, sticks, stick tricks and all kinds of fun things. I don't know. Let's just have fun from now on, okay? I'm done with my teaching stuff, I think, because I still go to teachers, all right? I think everybody should, and I don't think anybody's ever too good to go to a teacher. Even if you're amazing and there's something you want to learn, go and learn it from somebody else. I learn a lot of things from other people, and no matter what their skill is, if they're a beginner, if they're a pro, I learn from everybody. So I'd like to go into stick tricks. Okay, listen. Bottom line, this is how it works in video world. We edit, we take breaks, you don't know about it. We just took a break and we decided, okay, we can do stick tricks later. Right now, I want to jam. And another beautiful thing about editing is we just took these two things up here and we decided that we want to put them on number 6 and number 7 in your pamphlet. So by the time you get this tape, those will be in there, and you can practice them, and I just figured them out. We're going to come back with stories from Guns N' Roses, and we're going to just jam. I want to jam with Tony and Danny. Okay, so right now, let's rock, guys. Man, was that fun, yes or no? You have to say yes because I'm telling you to. No, it was great. It was unbelievable playing with these guys. They're unreal. I just had a great time. That's what we're here to do, is have a great time.
Hey, Fred, I heard you played for Guns N' Roses.
What's that?
I heard you played for Guns N' Roses. Tell me about it.
Yes, I did, Jerky. Okay, let me explain what happened there. That goes back to the Cinderella story. After, I was down on my luck, freaking out. I had no confidence in the world. I thought I was the worst drummer in the world. I would say, I'm hanging up the sticks. I'm done. I got a call out of nowhere, and that was Guns N' Roses' manager. And they said, learn your song that's on your answering machine, and we'll call you back in a couple hours. And I just thought it was a joke. Well, they called me, and they said, hey, this is the deal. Steven broke his arm. We want you to come out and fill in for however long it was, 2 weeks or 2 months. And I said, sure, I'll do it. So I was on a flight 3 hours later. I was in Minneapolis, no rehearsal, played with Guns N' Roses, ended up staying out there for 2 months, and did all the LA headlining shows. It was great, and it brought all my confidence back, and my band was like, whoa, you know? And they started figuring that I wasn't the worst. They never really thought I was, but I think it was just me, and it was in my head that I thought I was the worst drummer in the world until I did that. And it brought my confidence back, And it was the greatest thing, you know. It's still one of the most cool things I've ever done. It's playing with Guns N' Roses, and it was amazing. It was a lot of fun. Hey! Wake up! Okay. All right. Anyway, that's my Guns N' Roses story. I feel like it's a brush with greatness or something. Yes! Okay, now we're ready to do some fun things like stick tricks, okay? The most important thing, let me explain something to you right now. The most important thing about being on the road is, number one, is your bus clean? Are the wheels clean? Are they polished? Yes or no? Do I get a king-size bed? Yes or no? Do we have room service 24 hours a day? Yes or no? Okay? What's the hotel like? Major important things. Another important thing is stick tricks. You know, we don't care about anything else, now do we? No, we want to go up there and we just want to do our thing and this and that, and who cares? It looks killer. Okay, now what I want to do is show you the basic twirl, which is pretty much the only one I know. It's demonstrated like this. Looks kind of cool. Looks really hard, doesn't it? Ooh. I'd like to show you exactly how that's done. Really nothing to it, is there? No, it just goes back and forth, these fingers like that. Giving away tricks, I'm like a magician. More of a magician than I am a musician. Okay, now, we have this trick. If you're doing a side stick on your snare drum, and you want matched grip, like a baton twirl, I guess. And we have my specialty, which is the stick bouncing off of the snare. Looks great in concert. Don't do it in your basements because you're going to put holes in your roof and your parents are going to kill you, okay? And that's not good. So here's snare bouncing stick. We don't want to do that now, do we? No. We want to bounce the stick off of the drum like this. You always make sure you have a bag of sticks here so you can do it again. That's the way it's done. Okay, now, the way that happens is you move your stick, you hit the back end first on the rim, and then it hits the... You figure it out on your own. It took me a while. Anyway, I'm going to show you all these in a pattern right now. It's pretty... I'm going to try it. I've never done it before. Ready? Here we go. One, two... 3, 4. Can't believe I did that right. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. See, let me tell you here. The drum things don't work. People do not clap for my drum things. But when I do that stuff, I got the seals like yapping over here, okay? Killer. So, that's my stick tricks. Let me show you some videos that I did this special stick bouncing off of a drum thing. I think you're going to really like it. I invented it. And take a look at these. Oh, sorry. I was just doing those stick things that I invented. Well, not really. Okay, so Tommy Lee did show me that one. That was Tommy at the end, and I did borrow with taste, maybe? Okay, that's what I did. I borrowed with taste. He came up with it. I stole it. That's okay. Anyway, right now, I'd like to go into something I did with Cinderella, and that's When you can't really find the right fill for yourself or something, or if you just want to make your bandmates happy, ask them what you can do in a song, and they'll tell you different fills and go with it. It's the best thing is the constructive criticism from those people just saying, all right, try this fill, try this fill. There's a song called Dead Man's Road that I'd like to play for you right now, and then I'm going to break it down and show you what was in it and who I stole parts from and who I borrowed with taste from. And take a listen right now. Okay, we're back. And the first fill that was done was Tom. Actually, the first two is what Tom told me. I'm going to demonstrate them right now. One, two, three. Tom asked me to play those, and I really liked them. I thought they were great. The next one, Eric came up with, and Eric was always the one that would just come up with the coolest, weirdest things, and it'd take me a year to learn them, but once I learned them, I thought they were the coolest things in the world. I'll play that for you now. That was Eric's. Jeff couldn't come up with something, so he just said, play Moby Dick. And I said, okay, I will. That goes like this. The next one I came up with on my own. I stole it from Vinny Appice, the way Dio would say it, but Vinny Appice. And that was something I learned off a Dio record that I just borrowed with style once again. I'll play it for you now. Now I'll play them all together for you. So it's okay if your bandmates say, hey, I want you to play this fill. They usually come up with the coolest ones for you. And, you know, if you can't think of some, again, borrow with taste. All right, here's the good news. I've got a great new band called Arcade with Stephen Piercy, formerly of Rat. And I just got to play a lot of things that I've always wanted to play on a record. Again, the guys in the band said, here, try this and try that. But I'd like to play a couple of things for you right now. The intro to the first song on the record called Dancing with the Angels. I'd like to play that for you right now. One. Two. That was pretty close, if it wasn't it, but it was pretty close. What I wanted to do is just do some kind of jungle beat, but I wanted to keep it a little more grooving without getting into too many weird rhythms and keep it kind of straight. So what I did was I kept my hand riding on the floor tom doing eighths? Eighths? I don't even know. See that? I was doing eighth notes, and around it I kind of took the, again, borrowing the style, the Billy Idol thing from Rebel Yell, I believe it is. And I started doing the fills around it, and it just came out sounding like, you know, did you overdub that? No, I didn't. It was just, you know, made it a little bigger and fuller, and that's what that was. And then the build-up was from Deep Purple, Highway Star. So, I'm just a thieving kind of guy, aren't I? Okay, what I'd like to do next is a song called Living Dangerously. It's pretty much kind of a funky thing with a hi-hat opening here and there and doing this whole dance number. It's pretty much a dance beat as well. Take a listen right now. 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, you guessed it. Borrowing with taste once again in action. Yes, it is. Okay, get rid of this chord. Thank you. Okay, now, what that was it was taken from just some Zeppelin things and Tony Thompson and Def Leppard, different snare and kick patterns. Usually I don't know what I'm playing. When I go in there, I have something all made out, and I go in there and I mess it up and it turns into my fill. And it's happened all through the years. And it works. If you really concentrate on doing something too hard before it happens, you usually get to it and mess it up. So, I mean, know what you're going to play and go in there and play it, but don't concentrate too much on something too far away. If you get what I'm saying? I don't. It's 5 a.m. I don't know what I'm saying. But it's okay. So, let's go on now. Next, I'd like to talk about some studio things, techniques, and different ways I do things in the studio. I'd like to talk about the click track first and foremost. It's something I've had a problem with in the past, but I've overcome it by changing the click from a straight eighth note count, says a 1, 2, 3, 4 clicking sound, which has no motion at all, and it's pretty mechanical. It's really hard for me to, or for most people, I guess, to play around that. What I'd rather do is have 16th notes on a tambourine or a hi-hat, and also eighth notes on a cowbell. So that gives you the downbeats and stuff. But what you can do is just take a drum machine and really do anything with it. Just put anything in there that makes you feel good, except if you're not into the sound in your ear. I can understand that. Everybody can understand that. So try to change your click around, whatever you feel comfortable with, some percussion here and there, and just make it funky and make it happen and where you can play with the percussion section. It's a lot more fun. I'd like to also talk about bass drum padding. There's millions of different things you can do, and what I like to use is just a towel on the bottom of the bass drum and some shredded newspaper, about 2-inch thick strips, and the whole length of the newspaper, and just put about, I don't know, maybe a not even a quarter of your drum, maybe an eighth of the bottom of the drum in there, and then just lay something really light on top of it, something that'll hold it down. And it gives it enough muffling, but it gives it enough air movement, and it gives it some solid oomph, I guess you'd call it. Do we use that word anymore, oomph? I don't know. But that's what I like to use for that. Drums I like wide open. I never muffle them with anything. A lot of people put tissue paper or tape or something. A drum is meant to resonate. So I think if you just tune your drums right, you can really get away with just having the things ring and ring and ring. And that's what a drum's there for. And the scariest thing of all, the producer. Shouldn't let it freak you out, but if a producer tells you to play a certain fill, go with it and do it for that producer and see if it works. If he's wrong and you know you're right, do it anyway and he'll realize and it won't work for him. But you hire somebody like that to give him complete control of the situation and make the record sound right, So give it to him and play whatever he wants you to play. And it's usually the right thing to do. I've learned the hard way. Believe me, you don't want to go through that. Well, that's it. We're out of here. I'd like to thank everybody, the crew, the studio, Carmine, everybody for letting me be part of this. I'd like to thank you for listening along at home, watching along. And don't forget about the Power Rock timetable of contents. You can just get anywhere really easy just by following the numbers on your screen. Figure out what you want, what you don't want, fast forward, rewind, erase, whatever you want to do. And it's 4:30 in the morning. We're beat. I'm sure you're beat. You're bored. I'm not. I'm having a great time, but I have to go. So again, thank you, everybody. I'd like to say, everybody come out and see Arcade on the Road. I'll be out there, and you can come up and say hello. And I'll say, I remember everybody. It's great. I remember all of you. And right now, Tony, Danny, myself are going to jam. One more. I got one more jam left in me, and I want you to see it. Here it is. Thank you very much. And I'll see you on the road, 93. See you later. Thanks.
My kids will simply kill me if you don't sign a few things for them.
Great.
David.
David.
You've got charisma. Now, if I did my own rock video, I'd do it just... Wow! Hey, music fans! Oh, music. Listen, let me tell you something. Back when I was... You know... Hi, music fans! We're here? What the hell am I doing here? I have no clue. But I'm gonna... See, now that's how I should have done it. But I'll play it. Gonna have to turn around and look at this one, okay?
I account.
Is that what he wants?
Let's do it again. But do the two and one count within yourself and start.
Right. And then how long does he want me to be asleep?
What happened?
How long does he want me to be out?
Don't look at the camera ever.
Oh, okay, that's right.
Okay? Roll tape?
Still rolling.
More of a jerk.
And 5, 4, 3.
Yeah. Really? Are you still here? What's the matter with you people? Don't you ever sleep? Turn that machine off. What's wrong? It's 4:30 in the morning. Hey, off. Push stop. We're out of here. I gotta go.
Come on, let's go.
All right.
Come on.
You ready?
Yeah, all right. Hey, you know, come on, I'll buy you breakfast.
I'll eat it. I'm gonna get rid of this microphone
off,
thing.
You know, we'll go.
You go to sleep. Get a clue.
Shut it off.
Get a clue. How do I get this thing? I can't. I'm too tired. Would you help me?
We'll go get this off, and we'll go see Tommy Lee, man. Give him his video back.
I know. I'll steal more things from him. Thanks. Let's get out of here.
Turn it off. See ya.